idea, if you, want to ask my opinion, for example, if this is doable or not, if it has been done maybe by others already or something like this. So yeah, I'm really encouraging you to stay in touch in case you want to discuss something. All right, let us maybe move on to the substance. So what I was going to do in this third part, I was going to have a four different aspects, kind of extensions to what I was talking about yesterday. Okay? So there are four different elements that one can add in addition to this more sort of standard linear programming methodology. Each of those four is really very important, and sometimes you can add one of them, sometimes you can add to your model number three. And in this way you can get a more realistic model of some process that you want to study. Of course, there are many more aspects than these four, but yeah, so I will focus on those that I thought were the most important ones. So let us first talk about Nexus again. Yeah, so this is what we started from yesterday, and hopefully you remember my motivation part that water, as well as some other resources, are shared by different sectors. Yeah? So main customers, so to say, of water are agriculture and energy. Of course, households, of course, also need water. So you really have to address those questions in nexus, so in connection. Right? However, in reality, in practice, the silos are still in place. So different ministries, as we said, like they plan their operations more or less separately. Different, for example, activities are developing, I guess, in different countries. But so far, still the silo problem exists. Yeah? And that's why scientists are pushing very much for this more integrated, holistic systems analytical approach. And this is called what Nexus is. So we talked about this in principle yesterday, but we didn't really talk about how to model that. Yeah? So in our example that I considered last time or yesterday, so we only had a digital process. This was for simplicity for you to understand how this model works. Yeah? Remember, we had probe A and probe B, and we tried to divide the resources in an optimal way between these two probes. Right? So we only considered the agricultural sector. But as we many times mentioned, you can easily extend this methodology to model also the two sectors together. So agriculture and energy, you can model together. So in this part I'm showing here, I will show very briefly, without many technical details and without a long discussion, which we cannot record in terms of time, but I'll just give you an idea how one can do that. So this slide, for example, suggests that we can have, again, treated as a simplistic, very simplistic example, just for illustrative purposes. You can have model A, and I use A to kind of see that agriculture, so you can think that this is our crop model that we considered yesterday. And you can have model E, and by E, I can think that energy, right? But you can have also other systems, so other models. It's just an example. Alright, and then we had the structure of this model in this way so that we minimize the costs of this model, and please observe the different notations now. This is important. Technical detail, don't be confused. So I'm using now the upper index A for this sector and not for different crops within the sector. So remember we had crops A and B, and the index was the lower index. So we had, not to confuse you. So yesterday we had XA and XB, and that refers to probe A and probe B. Now, this was yesterday, now I'm using XA and XB, and this is the vector of many probes in agriculture, and that's why I'm using not to confuse with this, I'm using the upper. And here I will have different energy options, different technologies such as gas and oil and nuclear and renewables and so on. And this will be the vector of those, and this will be the vector of crops, and this will be the vector of different energy options. And so this is the notation that we are using now. Okay? So what do we have here? We have the problem of minimization of total costs across different options that you can use in agriculture. And you have the second model, where you also want to minimize the costs now by choosing an energy mix that satisfies to, again, your demand constraints are here, and the resource constraints that are here, right? So the demand constraints are, as yesterday, they are telling us that the total amount that we want to produce, the total amount of energy that we want to produce, should be at least a certain threshold, or more. Yeah? So we set the minimal limit of how much we want to produce. This is how usually the demand constraints look like. And the same demand constraints you also have in the agricultural sector. So you also set the minimal amount of the production that you want to achieve. Can also produce more. And then the second type of constraints that we have typically in such models are resource constraints. And because these are the availability constraints, of course they have the opposite sign. So you only have resources that do not exceed a certain amount again. Yeah? And you have a certain amount of resources. Now I'm using the notation R to kind of be more generic, so but you can think of R as quota, as we had yesterday, but it can also be some other resources, such as land, for example. So you only have a limited amount of resources, always, unfortunately. And here, I set a limit on the total amount of resources that is available to agriculture, right? And this is this constraint RA. And in the same way, I'm setting separately a constraint on the available resources for the energy sector, and this is R, is the index. And of course the positivity is always there, right? So this is what we dealt with more or less yesterday. So you now know that such models are called LP models, right? So these are linear programming models. For that, to solve it, the first thing to do is to construct the visible set, which is defined by these inequalities. Hope you remember our pictures and how the feasibility set is defined. And then you want to minimize the costs, and then you move the cost line until the cost line hits the feasibility set. This is what we had yesterday in detail. So now we can say we know how to solve model A separately, right? More or less. And we also know how to solve model E separately. Now the question is that they are interlinked. So in reality, the agricultural sector and model, of course, must be interlinked with the energy system and correspondingly with the energy model that represents the energy system. Right? So this is what we now want to talk about a little bit. So the suggestion here is that we don't really start from scratch. So there are many models in the world out there that already exist for separate sectors. It's not that we are starting it completely from the beginning. So for some regions and for some sectors, such quite detailed models actually have already been developed. And the line of thought currently is that we want to capitalize on those already existing models. And let's assume that for some region you already have a model for agriculture and a model of energy. So this is not uncommon for example, European countries. Or I presented to you a model for China yesterday, or for one province in China, in fact. So they do exist. So what we want to find a way how to keep the models separately, keeping them as modules, right? And then find some kind of way of linking those models. That would be the challenge. As an alternative to creating one joint model, of course you can always say these separate models are in the past, let's now create one joint model. That is always possible. So now a little bit of idea on how we want to do so. That's the same what we had in the first slide. And where is this connection coming from? So where is exactly this linkage? And the linkage is in the resource constraint. So in fact, for many years, the modeling groups, what they did, they set these separate constraints quite artificially. Yeah? Just because they had to do it for the modeling purposes. So otherwise you cannot model. Yeah? So if you have to model agriculture separately, then you have to somehow decide what is this amount of resources that is available to agriculture. And in the same way, you have to somehow decide separately what is this amount of energy, what is this amount of resources that is available for the energy sector? So you set the, let's say, so-called quotas, yeah, but quotas not in terms of kind of legal quotas, but quotas in terms of the model, for the model. And you say, okay, so let's assume that agricultural model receives this much resources and energy model receives that much. But in fact, this separation is rather artificial. Yeah? In reality, it's one amount of resource. Yeah? That's the thing. And that's why this is a very essential sort of weakness of the current generation of this kind of models. They are still useful. It doesn't mean that they should be thrown away and not used at all. For example, they can be used again, as I showed you yesterday, you can vary this this threshold, and you can see how the solution actually depends on it. This is already a good step forward towards this kind of linkage, because then you admit that the available resource is not fixed, and then you see how the solution changes, right? That's one way to do it. But to make the next step, you want to set actually a joint constant. Right? So you say that the total amount of resources to be used in agriculture, this is the first term here, plus the total amount of resources to be used in energy model now should not exceed the total available resources. I'm here for the simplicity, ignoring the households and potential other users, but you can add them in a more realistic model, right? So for the purpose of illustration, I'm assuming that we just have these two sectors, right? But I can tell you, even this kind of integration is very rarely done, almost never done. Yeah? And households and other ones is even more difficult, it's not really done at all. So even this kind of integration that is seemingly straightforward and seemingly sort of really necessary thing to do is not really done almost at all, or done very rarely. But this is what we want to do. So why is this so? Why is this a problem? There are many reasons for that. Maybe the main reason is that both models in this case are rooted in certain disciplines. And it happens so that the disciplinary communities are working sort of on their own, and this kind of multidisciplinary interaction that is absolutely necessary condition for such integration to take place still is quite problematic. It is still very difficult to find common language across the different disciplinary communities. People really speak different languages. It's very hard to understand what, I don't know, for example, for me as a mathematician, it's very hard to understand what a biologist is saying, what kind of notions they operate, and so on, and vice versa. Yeah, vice versa, I think, is even difficult. So this kind of multidisciplinary, cross-disciplinary research is developing, but it's still, it's quite an in its infancy at the moment. So, let's see. So here I list three different options. Again, this is just for the purpose of your overview. In order to go into details how to do this on the technical side, you would need, I don't know, maybe three lectures of that length that we have today. So I really cannot even start talking about it. It's just as an overview for you to see that what are the options, right? And there are many more options, but I just list the three most common ones, so to say. So a while ago, it has been suggested that such kind of integration that I showed in the previous slide could be treated in the framework of so-called generalized mesh equilibrium setting. So the mesh equilibrium notion suggests that this comes from game theory, and those of you who are familiar with that can already guess maybe where we are heading to. So basically what it is suggested is that the two models can exchange the quotas in an iterative way. Yeah? So let's look at this here. So if I know how much, the logic is very straightforward. If I know how much the energy model is consuming of water, for example, how much water the energy model consumes, I can subtract from the maximal available resource and say, okay, therefore the agricultural model has just this. Yeah, this amount. Then you can solve the model and see if it really does so, if it really uses the whole available resource or not. And if not, then you can say, okay, actually agriculture needs this much. And then you send this information, you send this information back to model E, resolve it again and send it back and so on. So they can exchange in this way with quotas until they arrive at the so-called equilibrium, which means that they don't change anymore. Yeah, so they exchange this information and they learn through that exchange what are the optimal quotas for each of them. This is a very natural, very straightforward idea. However, mathematically it has a few problems. So you can, in principle, set it, but it was shown in a very simple example that sometimes the solution does not exist for this kind of process. Sometimes it is not unique. This means that you can run this process two times, and two times you can get two different solutions, or you run it 10 times, you get 10 different solutions. So that is kind of a problem, because if you want to come up with a recommendation for policy, you cannot come up with 10 different ones. Or sometimes you see that this process does not converge. Yeah? So all of this is not guaranteed for this kind of problem. This means that in reality, it is very often used. And kind of researchers are hoping that in this particular case, this is not a problem. And indeed, in many applications, yeah, you can solve it. But there is always this danger that your particular application may not actually be solvable by this method. So then, as I mentioned already, you can do the so-called hard integration. You just bring the two models together. So what is the problem here? Let's see. So you actually have two different objective functions here. Right? So we do know how to solve the model with one objective function. This is a standard classical optimization theory. When you have two objective functions, this is much less clear. That's why, by the way, this game theoretic idea actually is quite natural to apply here. So you really, for the optimization theory to be useful here, you have to transform your two objective functions into one. And the most straightforward way to do it is to just sum them up and to say that now we are aiming to optimize the total cost, so the joint cost of the agriculture model and the energy model. And this is, in literature, is called usually so-called socially optimal solutions. Yeah? So you basically take care of all the costs involved and you want to minimize them. So it makes some sense. What you can also do is a simple extension here, you can put different weights. You can say that, for example, because of the food security issues, I want to prioritize the agriculture sector for some country, that makes some way make sense, right? And you can say I put a higher weight on the agricultural sector, and therefore I put a lower weight on the energy, or vice versa, for example. Yeah, so that is also possible, and that can also be done in exactly the same way. So if you do that, this means that you have to bring these different modeling teams together. So you previously had the agriculture model separately, energy model separately, now you really have to make them work together. So as Dr. Afri was saying, this is a social process. So modeling is actually a social process. So sometimes it's not so easy to do. Again, as mentioned, so different languages can be a barrier, different modeling frameworks can actually be a bit different. There can also be a problem with different data, so the data may not be actually consistent. So when you want to bring the two models together, you also have to ensure that your data is consistent across these two models and so on. So there can be different issues. And it's not impossible to overcome them, but it would take some effort to do so. And finally, there is a technical problem that the code there will become really gigantic. So you already have the very big models. If they are detailed models, as we said yesterday, the number of variables can reach up to 10,000 or even higher. So now if you bring several models, you can have, for example, not two, but more models, so then the code really becomes huge, right? So that's another just technical complication, but one has to take into account as well. And there is an alternative method that has been developed at YASA actually a while ago, and now we are kind of reviving it and try to apply it to these global models that the YASA is working with. I mentioned them yesterday also, the energy model called the message model and the land use model that is called the bio model. So now we want to use this methodology to integrate those models. And this methodology is actually based on decentralized integration. So we keep the models as they are, and we arrange in between a so-called central hub. And I hope you remember this probably most complicated part of my lecture yesterday, this dual problem. Yeah? We have primal problem and we have the dual problem. And the dual problem is a technical construct, but it is helping us in this case, for example, to organize the central hub. A again, as I said, so if we wanted to go into details here and write all the formulas, so it would take several hours to explain this, but just, yeah, maybe you can just have this kind of words in mind that what is organized is an iterative process of exchanging information, similarly to how the generalized mesh equilibrium does, but not directly, but instead there is a central hub in between, and what they are actually sending to the central hub are these dual variables that we talked about before. And it was proven that this process, as opposed to the mesh equilibrium, the general mesh equilibrium method, actually converges to the socially optimal solution. So these solutions of the hard integration and the decentralized integration are the same ones. Just that you arrive at it differently, and you arrive at it by this iterative procedure, and we believe that it's actually more cost efficient than to recode everything in one software. So this kind of methods are now possible, as you can see. So they are technically possible. They are going to be implemented hopefully soon. And in this way, yeah, these more truly integrated solutions can be derived. Before I go to the second part, as always, I will stop at this. And if you have questions to this part, one of the questions you can take. No questions? Very good. Exactly. Absolutely. There is a conflict between two objectives, and we saw it yesterday on my trade-off thought at the end of the talk. That remember there was this term. So we had coal here, and we have crops here. This, I showed this for the Shanxi province in China, and we have a picture like this, if you remember, right? So there is a trade-off. So if you want to produce more crops, you have to reduce the coal and vice versa, right? So exactly, that's the core of this. Yeah, but exactly, but that is outside of the method. This is what the decision maker has to decide. Yeah, there will always be, absolutely. So by giving different ways, you can actually arrive either here or here. So you will actually explore the full trade-off curve, or it's also called sometimes Pareto optimal curve. And if you vary the weights, you can either arrive at something that prioritizes coal, and of course, in that way, you sacrifice the crops, or vice versa, you prioritize crops and you sacrifice the coal. Of course, magic is not possible with this model, so we cannot at the same time maximize one and another because of the resource constraints. But what we can do, we can at least define where we want to be. Yeah? And then, of course, yeah, accept the cost that comes there, so there is no other way. Yeah, that's exactly the essence of it.
Is there any development of interface between two models or rules for the integration?
That's what I was trying to say here, that the special software should be developed to make them interface, yeah, to make them sort of exchange the information.
Anything developed yet or not?
Not yet, yeah, not yet. That's exactly the plan at the moment, that we are discussing to develop such a software that not only our models, for example, but any model. Yeah? So in ideal life, after all this is done, maybe in several years, there should be a software where everybody can come with their model, plug it in, and do that. But this is not ready yet.
It's a examples in agricultural models. Mm-hmm. We have different interfaces to combine different models.
Yeah. Yeah, it depends how they are combined again. So, as I said, so they can be combined in different ways, and depending how they are combined, you can get different outcomes. Okay, so I suggest that we move on because the time is very short. And the second aspect that is really essential to this kind of questions, and we hear about them a lot, is nonlinearity. Yeah? We hear about it all the time, that our world around us is nonlinear, so it cannot be modeled by linear models, and it is very important to take this nonlinearity into account. So far, we talked about linear programming models, and it may seem that as if we are only dealing with linear problems, which is not exactly true, or we can extend it to nonlinear case. One has to modify a little bit the method, but essentially it's based on the same kind of methodology. So again, I can only give you a very, very quick idea, and we can't go into details. And to give this idea, I thought it would be easy to just focus on our two crop example from yesterday, because it seems that it was quite clear. Right? I hope you remember. So we have now two crops again, so don't be confused again with the indices. So we have crops A and B. We go back to the pure agricultural model. We have our demand constraint and we have the water constraint, all as it was yesterday. And we want to minimize the cost. And in this way, while we were modeling it like this, of course the cost will linear, right? So and this is illustrated here in this plot. So if you have the production volume here, then the total cost is a linear function of the production volume. Yeah? Basically this is the function. So the production function here, the cost function here will be cost is C times production. And then you apply this function to two crops, to A and B. Okay? So this is a linear function. We all know that the cost function may be nonlinear. For example, because of the effect of the economy of scale. So if you have a small farm, you can have actually higher marginal cost compared to big, agri food corporations, right? Because they have a possibility to employ the so-called economy of scale. Like that. So how would the cost curve look like if we want to take into account the economy of scale? Who knows? How should I draw the cost curve? So this is the linear one, so the benchmark, so like this. Any other suggestion? That's a dream situation. You know where the cost curve looks like this, let me know. I want to invest in that business and be here. Or here, so it would be even nice. So that is maybe not very likely, but something similar, yeah? So something like this, right? So it's less than linear. When the production is big, so you can have less than linear increase, but of course it cannot go down. Or at least under normal circumstances it will not go down. So let's say it's like this, right? So how can we model it in the framework of linear programming model? So is there a way to somehow take into account the effect of the economy of scale? The way is approximation. So one can approximate this concave curve by this kind of piecewise linear approximation. And I can of course take just one point and two segments, but I can take many points. And in this way I can have very good approximation, right? And actually in the limit I can even have the perfect approximation. So I can do like this, right? And then I can do like this, and so on. So the more segments I have, the closer I can get to the actual curve. So in principle it's a good approximation, and everything it depends on our computing power, because with the increase of those segments, of course, you would need to make more calculations. We will see now how, but in principle, essentially, this effect can be captured. So let us see how the linear programming models will be transformed in case of our example, if we want to do it this way, and if we want to do it just with one point and the two segment approximation. So how should we do that? In the interest of time, I guess I will show. So we would split this model into two parts. Yeah, we will solve one model, so here is index one, So we will solve one model in this place, in this area, and we will have a separate or additional constraint that our volumes of production should not exceed this x bar. So, and then in this way we have just a normal classical LP problem. And then we will have a second one in this area. So we just split them into areas. And in each area we have a linear programming model. And again, as I said, so if you have 10 different segments, so you just split them into 10. So it's just that the computing power has to be, available. And then what can happen is that one of them may not have a solution. Remember, we had the feasible set problem, the emptiness and boundedness and so on. So very likely that only one of them will have a solution and another one will not. And the one that has a solution will be the solution we are looking for. If it happens so that both have the solution, then you have to look closely into that and see why it is happening. But under normal kind of circumstances, yeah, most likely you will only have one, and that's a very practical way of taking nonlinearities into account. So don't be sort of misled. It's a very common misperception. When people criticize this kind of linear programming models and they say, oh, this is an old stuff that was invented in the 50s and 60s, because yeah, they don't take into account so many things. They don't take into account the most essential thing, which is nonlinearity. No, they do. So, or they can do if you program it in a smart way. Right? So quite a powerful tool in that. Questions to that part? See, we are moving very fast these days. Yes. Yeah. Of course, there are always limitations. You're right. However, this kind of cycled constraints or objective functions are not very common. Yeah, many applications would rather look like this, but I agree, of course, there are limits to this kind of approximations. That's cool. The cycles and this very irregular behavior, it will be increasingly more complicated to arrange such kind of approximations. Yeah.
One question. By using this model, how we can interpret the climate change on the crop productivity?
Big models are created of how indeed the climate change or other transformations, other changes, but yeah, let's say climate change are affecting this. So where would the most important impact sit? Yeah? Most likely it will sit in the water availability, right? So, and then you have to have a separate model that models that. So it's not part of this, but you have a separate model that tells you, and actually the next slides will be showing the dynamic version of this, and there it's more, it's maybe easier to see that, but even here we can see. So one can model specifically how this water constraint, for example, depends on the climate change. Right? You also have other aspects, and as we said yesterday, so we should, this is just an illustrative example. In reality, you have many different constraints, and in some of the parameters there, you have the dependency on the climate change. And then you can run different scenarios of 2 degrees warming, of 3 degrees warming, and so on, and see how your solution depends on those, for example. So this is how it's done now, and this is something that that is really, let's say, the cutting edge of this modeling exercise. Let's look at the dynamics. Dynamics is another aspect that, again, a lot of misperception exists. So, of course, the initial setting of the LP problems is a static one. Yeah, you don't have the time dimension. So we didn't talk about time. But it is quite possible to include the dynamic aspects into this modeling framework as well. Again, the easiest would be to understand it using our GPROP example. So it's quite straightforward. So assume that this initial model was formulated for 1 year. Yeah? So now if we want to formulate it for 2 years, for example, we have a planning horizon of 2 years. Yeah? Just as an example. So how would we do that? Any ideas? It can be two independent, right? That's one way. And then we would need to link them. tricky. That's actually a good point. It's not the answer that I prepared, but that's a good point. That can be done this way. Or it can be done, of course, as a one model again, right? One can also do it as a one model. And then you again have to sum up all the costs. Yeah? So you have the cost now in parentheses, I have the time moment. So this is year one and this is year two. And in the very simplest, so that's the simplest what you can do, is you just sum up all the costs and then you solve. Yeah, and then of course you have the two constraints on water, you have two constraints on demand, and this kind of flow productivity constraint. Yeah? So, and then again, this one is just the canonical LP problem and it can be solved in this way. Or alternatively, exactly, it can be two separate problems for two separate years and then you have to link them. Both ways are, of course, possible. So now if you have n years, so any years ahead of us, so what can we do? We can do the same. So we sum the costs of a certain year, of year t, and then we sum them over all years. And then we have for every year, we have an availability constraint on water and on demand and so on. And here you can see, to the previous question, that we can also vary the water availability, for example, and the demand availability. So you can embed the projections for future into here. So you can say, from some other research we know that because of climate change, because of some other aspects, we have this kind of scenario of water availability. Yeah, or rather this kind of scenario. So let's just plug it in here and solve this. And the same for demand. So if you have a growing population, then you kind of assume that maybe per capita consumption will also grow at a certain rate. So then you can say, we can calculate the scenario for the demand in future and plug it in and see, given these scenarios, what is our optimal strategy in that case. And then you can vary those scenarios. You can have many scenarios and then see what, how the solution changes. Here I want to emphasize an important aspect that those of you who are familiar with economic models certainly know about very well, but let me mention this. A very important parameter in such models is a so-called discount factor. So economists are saying that we actually discount the future. And this means that the present time for us is more important than future. It's very controversial, so there's a lot of debate in literature. What is the proper discount rate? Maybe it should be set to zero. How the solution depends on the discount rate. But anyhow, this is a very conventional way of taking into consideration the fact that, of course, what happens in 100 years from now somehow is really sort of less important for us. Yeah. So we live now and the short-term goals are just by definition are more relevant, so to say, for us than the longer term. For different problems, this discount factor is set at different levels. And again, usually a good modeling exercise would also include the sensitivity analysis of the solution with respect to this discount factor. But anyways, this is how it's typically done now. And this is a technical way to do it. You add a multiplier here. So in front of this term here, you add this multiplier. And here row is the discount factor. And the typical values for discount factors are between 1 and 5%. This is very rough estimate, but that is probably all true in most of the studies. And you can see that with time, this function decreases. So it's actually, again, an exponential decrease over time. So if you add this discount factor, then of course your solution to this problem will change. That's something to have in mind. So what I showed was a kind of a simple and intuitively clear and straightforward way of doing the dynamics. There's also a more advanced way of doing that, of course. And again, I'm only mentioning it here for your information. Usually people take classes at least a semester long to study at least the basics of this, but here I just mentioned it in 5 minutes. So just for your information, that you can also go to continuous time setting, right? So in the previous one, we had discrete time. We had every year was a time moment. This is so-called discrete time setting. It is useful and this applies in many cases, but you can also have a so-called continuous time setting, and this is a typical continuous time optimization problem. And the field of mathematics that studies it is called optimal control. So the typical canonical way of representing an optimal control problem is this. So you have an objective function here, and this is an integral of some utility function over time. And the time can also be set to infinity, and it's often done in economic applications because we don't really know when is our time horizon ends. For some applications, it is quite meaningful to set it to a certain time though. And then you have dynamics that is captured by this differential equation. The dynamics can describe, for example, a typical one would be to describe the dynamics of the so-called production factors, which are capital, labor, natural resources, knowledge base, and so on. So there will be equations that describe how these production factors evolve over time. And very important element here is the control. So U is a control function. This is how you control the system. This is what we previously had was denoted by X and was a decision variable, what we called in the past, in the previous slides. Yeah? So now it is U. It's a convention to use this notation that I'm using it here. So U is now your control, and the control can be chosen or should be chosen from a certain set. And then what you want to do, you want to move your system from some initial condition, maybe to some terminal condition. Sometimes one of this is set free, so sometimes there is no constraint on it, but in general sense, this is the way how the optimal control problem is represented. So abstracting from complicated mathematics, just try to understand the substance here. And the substance is simple, that you have a system and you want to change the condition or the state of the system from point A to point B. But because there are multiple ways to do it, yeah. So if I have to go from here to airport, for example, I assume there are many roads which I can take to be there, right? I can even go via Karachi, yeah? That's in principle possible, right? And then, depending on my objective function, the way to via Karachi can be actually an optimal if I want to visit Karachi, right? So then everything that I want to achieve is sitting here, and different ways of doing that are described by the differential equation. And so when I optimize this objective function, I choose a way that reaches or allows me to reach this objective function. This kind of problems initially started from military and space applications, but this is of course where you really need to solve those. So you send a flying object from point A to point B, and probably you want to do it either in fastest time or you want to spend the least fuel to that and so on. So this is a very, these were the very first applications of this method. So these are the two gentlemen again, different ones. So yesterday, Lev Pankragin from Russia, who invented the so-called maximum principle, and Richard Bellman from the US, who invented the dynamic programming approach. And the two approaches allow you to solve those problems that I showed in the previous slide. So again, the mathematical part of them is quite complicated, it's very advanced. But once you study it, you can solve many optimization problems. And now not only in military and space problems, since a while already, so these kind of methods and these kind of settings are also used in economic and environmental applications. So students who study at economic departments learn a lot of this and solve this kind of problems. And they can really allow to discover very interesting phenomena. Dynamics can bring very interesting new phenomena that you don't observe when you consider it in a static way. So dynamics, of course, is very important. Let me also emphasize here that this setting is what links my lectures, the lectures of Dr. Afrin, because she was showing you, essentially, systems that are described by this equation. Yeah? There was no optimization there. But the system dynamics that was shown in the previous lectures is nothing else but a particular case of this kind of equation. So it's a linear, ordinary differential equations that are behind the systems dynamics tool that was shown. So if you have, for example, a model in WISS that was shown, or in any other software, you can write it down as equations, and then you can decide what parameter of those you want to control. Then you set the objective function, and then you can solve it in this case. Yeah, so these two methods, it's very important to understand that what we are showing are not two separate kind of things. They are very much intermixed. All right. One more part, go. Yes? But before that, questions. No. So they can be specified for the time, right? So you can specify for a particular year different values.
If there is all prior conditions, for example, jobs,
yep.
And for example, anything yes. Beyond all,
right.
How we can interpret
here? Fourth part is coming. The fourth part is coming that is addressing this. Yeah. Okay, so the last part of the talk today deals with the even more advanced methodology that is called stochastic optimization. Again, this is only to give you a very, very brief idea. To understand that one needs to read many books and have a few courses, but just so that you know that it exists and sort of what kind of problems they consider. And this is exactly what this uncertainty that was mentioned is actually treated or can be treated at least in this paper. With some limitations as always. So what we see is that indeed, as was just mentioned, right? So all those parameters that we talked about in real life are changing over time. And they are changing sometimes in a very chaotic way, so to say. Yeah? For example, just here a few examples, I picked the prices. So there is a market volatility here, there is a volatility of prices on crops, and it's on a few crops, so you can see year to year, so this is from 2005, 2012, I would say. So this is how they jump, yeah? So it's not insignificant. And of course, the problem is that we cannot predict the future. We can have some guesses, but we can never predict, at least so far, no methodology is able to predict this kind of behavior. Yeah? This is not possible. So the same holds for prices on energy carriers. Again, here you have some coal prices in particular. Even coal that is not so volatile as oil, for example, but even for coal you can see that over, let's say, 20 years time horizon, the volatility of prices is quite high. So there are also other factors that can be uncertain or volatile, natural factors in particular. So weather, year to year, so we can have very dry year, we can have very wet year. Again, absolutely impossible to predict which year specifically is going to be this or that. Yeah? So that's at least at the moment, no one can predict with certainty. So rainfalls, water discharge in rivers, and so on and so forth. There are many, many factors that are uncertain. So the scientists, of course, recognize that, and so far have come up with the idea that how to, even conceptually, what to do with. So one idea that they have come up with is the so-called robust planning or robust solution. Yeah? So what is the robust solution? This is a solution that is sort of good on average, as it was said, but it is a solution that is avoiding big catastrophes. Yeah? It's in a very simple language. So you really want to kind of ensure that at least you are prepared to the worst possible outcome. Again, it kind of has a link with what was shown before, that if you have like 20% damage, for example, from floods, you can somehow cope with that. But if you happen to have like a really big flood, for instance, that damages like 80% of your capital stock, for example, so most likely you're not going to survive. Yeah? So this kind of methodology that I'm showing here allows you to kind of plan for those rare, but high impact events. Again, very difficult to, in 5 minutes, to explain the technical part of it, but just to give you an idea what kind of notions this theory operates with. So this is a probabilistic distribution that I'm showing here, an example of it. So it's a normal distribution, random distribution. And it is shown in two versions, in discrete versions. So these bars is a discrete version of the normal distribution, and the continuous line here is a classical standard normal distribution. So what does it tell us? In very simple language, it tells us the probability. So on the y-axis is a probability of a certain event, and the event is on the horizontal axis. For example, you can think of this plot describing the loss distribution from floods. Yeah, what was shown before is that big floods are very rare. So you would have big floods in the tail here. But the more sort of, the less severe is the flood, the more frequently usually they occur. So this plot, of course, does not represent it very well. So you have to cut the left side. So, of course, there are different distributions of different shapes that describe different events or different stochastic processes. But in principle, you have to kind of understand that if you have a random process which you cannot predict in future, usually this randomness or this uncertainty is represented by a distribution. And then this distribution has to be derived from data. It can have different shapes, for example, like this, but also can be, of course, something else. Quite typical that these distributions have tails. Tails are these parts. And they describe this kind of rare events that we see. And we are interested in these rare events, which have high magnitude. So high losses, for example, from floods. Or, some other rare events, but those that are associated with high losses. So the conceptual task now is to somehow integrate these probabilistic distributions into the linear programming framework. This is what the stochastic optimization is doing. Let's see how far we can go with that. So first I'm showing a very simple principle. Now without any distribution. So this is, if you remember, this was our general optimization problem that we mentioned yesterday. Not even a linear one, you can just have any function here that you want to optimize. In this case, let's say you want to maximize this function over x. X is our decision variable, as usual, and P is parameter. Parameters are exactly those parameters we mentioned before, what availability can be, prices on the market, and so on. Yeah? So if we specify that parameter, let's say we have the what availability this much, and price will be this much, and so on. So once we specify them, we can solve this optimization problem and get a solution. But the solution is dependent on the parameter. So if you give to the model different parameters, then of course you get a different solution. Yeah? This is expressed in this form, that x star, that is a solution to this problem, is a function of parameters. And in some cases, relatively simple cases, you can actually derive this dependency, and you can plot it. You can show how your solution depends on the parameters. But this is only in simple cases. If this is not possible, and if you want to have kind of account for the uncertainty in these parameters, this is what, for example, what you can do. That's the simplest way. And conceptually, this is quite clear. So if your parameter P is uncertain, but you want to maximize this goal function, this objective function, for sure. Yeah? For example, you want to maximize it for sure. So then what would you do? You would minimize the function over the parameter P and then maximize it over X. What does it mean? This is so you take the worst outcome and you maximize over it. Right? For example, if I'm going for a trip to a desert and I'm thinking how I can prepare, and there's a lot of uncertainty about it. For example, I have no idea how the desert looks like and what it is like to be in a desert. I have no idea, and I can say, well, maybe it is this. Yeah, maybe it will be hot, but maybe not too hot. So I can take one bottle of water, for example. Maybe I can take two bottles of water if it is actually warmer than I think, and so on. So this would be this dependency. But if I want to guarantee that I survive in the desert, then I say, okay, what is the really, truly worst situation? The worst situation is that, I need 10 bottles of water, for example, and then for sure I can survive. So then I do this. Yeah, I take the worst outcome and I optimize them over them. The same kind of idea, one can also think of more other applications of the kinds that we discussed, so energy and agriculture planning, you can sort of count on the worst environmental conditions. Count always on the dry season, and then sort of build your irrigation system, for example. Yeah. And this kind of approach is mathematically expressed in this so-called min-max approach. So this is something that, again, very much studied in mathematics. A lot of theories behind that, but conceptually is just that. And this is one simple way how you ensure that at least for the, or not at least, but in the worst case, you are already optimizing. And then, of course, if the real case is actually better than the worst, then you are safe, and then you still sort of within the limit, right? The problem with this is that this can be very costly. So if you always count on the worst, so you can actually lose, you can lose potentially kind of better solutions which you have to dismiss because they did not satisfy this fourth condition. But in reality, the worst case has relatively rarely, right? So what would you do then? This is when these distributions actually come into play. And you can decide for yourself where is your, I should have actually put it rather here, but conceptually it's the same. So you can decide where is your limit that you are ready to accept. Yeah. So where is this rareness threshold, so to say, where you are ready to take the risk. So if, for example, you have for the flood events, for instance, they always talk about 10-year events, 20-year events, 100-year events, 1,000-year events. Right? So this is the way to say that there are floods of that severity that only happen, let's say, once in 100 years. So then it's a 100-year event. Or once in 1,000 years. Yeah? So you can say that I want to plan for those situations that are, let's say, do not exceed the 100-year event. Then, of course, what can happen is that a more rare event can still happen. But the probability is so small that you say, well, I accept this. Yeah? But why do I do it? I do it because if I don't do it, then I spend much more. So this is to say, this is again another trade-off that is here. There is a trade-off between costs and this kind of safety that you get if you account for very rare. So this is again a decision that mathematics cannot take. So this is something that the decision makers have to decide for themselves. What mathematics do, they can again build this kind of trade-off first, where you have risks on the one hand and costs on the other. And what we can do with this kind of models, we can quantify those trade-offs and say, this is the trade-off, but where on the trade-off you want to be, this is what mathematics cannot do. This is beyond the technical part of modeling. This is again the social process. This is where what the scientists should do, we should be able to explain what this means to the decision makers and let them decide where they decide to be on that road. So essentially, one would use this kind of idea of cutting the distribution or cutting off a certain tail of the distribution, relatively small tail, and say, now we are formulating our objective so that we take into account this part, but we can ignore this very unlikely event. But we realize that, of course, we can have some unexpected losses due to that approach. So there are different ways of doing it technically. I don't think I'm showing it, no, I'm not showing it. So this takes really, really many equations to write, but at least we now can have an idea. The different question is where those distributions come from. That's again, if you run this, you really have to have the distribution. So usually what is done, you take it from the past, because the past data is the only source of information that you have. And then if you have reasons to assume that this past distribution is somehow going to continue at least for the next like several years, usually you can assume that. So then at least for the short term, you can use the past data. Yeah? For the future, you have to model it. And that's a separate question. How to model this variability? This is the other type of model that deals with that. But anyhow, you obtain this distribution from some sources from whatever is available, and of course you recognize that it's not perfect, and you recognize all the limitations of any of this approach will have limitations, naturally. And it's important to realize them, but even the limitations you still derive those solutions, and they really are very informative. They really, especially this kind of trade of course that we looked at yesterday, they really sort of open eyes sometimes to, you know, to see these numbers and to see how they are connected. Very good. So here, if there are questions to the technical part, and then I have still one more slide to show you, but this is not on the resource allocation problem. Questions to this part? No questions. And then, yeah, this is just a small advertisement here. We talked about the EASA yesterday a little bit. So this is how the place looks like, or part of the place looks like. And in particular, I want to mention that we have this so-called Young Scientist Summer Program. This is a program for PhD students who are enrolled in the PhD program. Every year we host about 50 international participants from all over the world. And they stay with us for 3 months, June, July, and August. And they do a small research project with one or more EASA scientists. So usually they do it so that either it's a part of their PhD, or it's an extension maybe to the PhD, or so somehow, of course, it's related to what they are doing. And sometimes it ends up being a joint paper. Sometimes we actually continue this collaboration much, much beyond the summer. So yeah, it really is a very good opportunity for you to, for all participants to you know, to build a network, to interact with people from different disciplines, from different cultures, from different backgrounds, even different age, and so on. So most of our participants are very excited when they leave. They tell us that this was really a very, very unique and useful experience for them. So yeah, this is something for you to consider. You can look it up online. And for information, you can contact the Pakistani National Member Organization. Its abbreviation NMO stands for National Member Organization. And we are privileged here to have actually the council member of EASA. So Pakistan, Dr. Ali, who is here. Yeah, so please be aware of this. There are also other possibilities to collaborate with us. So we quite often we host students or young researchers who come from different countries. They receive scholarships to go abroad. And they come to us and we run a joint project, for example. Again, this kind of collaboration can continue longer than those visits. The example that I showed yesterday on China, on Shaanxi province, is actually an example of such very good collaboration. The PhD student from China came to us, she spent a year with us, and completely so from scratch we built that model, the results of which I showed you yesterday. So, and we continue collaborating now, plan new projects, submit proposals, and so on. So this kind of visits can really be a good starting point of much longer research that we could do together. So consider that, and with that, I thank you for your attention, and again, don't hesitate to get in touch with me if you have questions. Yeah. Right, so for the deadline for applications to this program is usually something like 10th of January. So yeah, you can see all the details. Yeah, every year. You can see all the details, what should be submitted online, it's all here, and
for
general questions, yeah.
We have a problem why the participant doesn't do this much. He's also here, he can answer questions. And unfortunately, today we have the council member, Dr. Problem member, also there. Feel free to explore this. If you have any technical questions regarding the presentation, then go ahead.
Thank you, Dr. Elena. It's your last experience now, I think. We spent 3 hours and 30 minutes with you, and you of course focused on the system's optimal resource allocation for the some sort of agri-based or irrigation-based crops. As we are the blend, sitting here the blend, and belongs to the various fields of the engineering. So basically I belong to the water management system, that is a sewerage system. So if you're in a position to give some outline for me and how we can apply all the optimal resource allocation, that whatever, in the three lectures, on the solar system, are you in a position now? Or I will be spending some time to read through this literature, but if you give some one or two sentences about that, and how we can apply these techniques to the solar system.
You mean photovoltaic, yeah? So as mentioned many times, you can apply it to many different fields, yeah? All you have are different options which have different costs. So I'm not an expert in this field by no means, but I'm sure you can tell me actually, so what are the different options of implementation of different technological solutions? Yeah, there are different options. There are also different locations, and in different locations you have different costs as well. So once you have this information, you can apply this methodology directly. Yeah? You have the choice of placing your, let's say, solar panels either on roofs of houses, or you can place them in a field, or you can do, I don't know, I'm not an expert in this, but once you have options, and you can estimate costs, and of course there will be a lot of uncertainty, and of course there will be a lot of assumptions, but this is how all models work. So then you evaluate these different combinations, so for example, locations and technologies, and then you choose an optimal one. So this would be the outline, and we can of course discuss it in more detail if you want, but again, this applies to any problem where you have options with different costs, potentially different in different locations.
Thank you.
All right, so let's give a big hand. Thank you.